back, and we just had Kevin Allen on the show, who wrote an article about how fighting is down 25% at PowerScoutHockey.com. They've had a few interesting articles up there as of late. They kind of call it the money ball of NHL hockey, and Terry Appleby joins us now. Terry, how you doing?
Very good, thank you.
You guys had that article as far as, you know, the momentum from fights, and we're seeing less and less fights, so obviously I'm guessing there's chance, you know, less and less chance of momentum being built off of those. I know you guys had wrote the article, and, you know, I was reading some comments on the internet, some people wondering about, you know, how accurate that was or not. It's more so based on emotion, is it not, Terry, or what did you come up with in that study?
Yeah, that's right. What we've done is we've created an algorithm that measures how much effort a team is putting in when they're playing. Picture it as a car where the team is sitting on the accelerator. If the momentum goes up, they press down on the accelerator and the car goes faster. Likewise, if they're not doing that, the car slows down and momentum slows down. What we've done is with our algorithm is determine, you know, a start and an end point for a fight. In other words, we've been able to measure or get a value for a fight when it starts, and then measure it again 3 minutes later and see whether the value is higher or lower. And what we've done is we've measured 1,563 fights over the last two years up to December 21st. And what we found is that on average, the team goes up by about a tenth of a goal per fight, which works out to about 60 wins or 60 fights to create a win.
Do you recall in compiling these fights, did you take a look at the Steve McIntyre Rytus Evanen's fight, the one in which ended Evanen's season and the Oilers won that hockey game?
Well, it was late in the game, though, so I don't know if it matters, right? It's 4-0
No,
game.
We didn't look at individual fights. We looked at them as a group. What we wanted to see is whether there was any response from a fight, and so the 1,563 fights were broken down into various categories of whether one team or the other increased in momentum. And what we found is it's a 50-50 situation as to which team will increase, although 23% of that total is when both teams increase their momentum. On the other hand, there's only 4% of the time when both teams decrease. In other words, they take their foot off the accelerator and they play at a lower level. If your team happens to start get into a fight when you're playing at a low level of momentum, there's a high likelihood you'll increase your momentum, which will lead to more goals, which in course leads to more wins. And in that case, if you got into a fight or your team got into a fight and their momentum rose by roughly about double what it would be normally, you only need 30 fights then to get a win. But that's kind of a staged fight where you kind of make the fight happen when you want to motivate your team. Most fights seem to happen spontaneously, so the actual increase is probably closer to 60 fights for a win.
Something else, and I think it was your son Mark talking about how, I don't know, are you guys finished your study on the importance of power play versus penalty kill?
I don't know if we actually had a study. We've been doing it. It's an ongoing kind of thing. We go from year to year. We measure the importance of penalty killing and power play percentages relative to winning.
Okay, and how did you come up with that the penalty kill, it was, if I'm not mistaken, three times more impactful? How so, though?
Well, I mean, it's an analysis, and what we found is that 54% of winning is at even strength. And 36% is at penalty killing, and only 10% is power play. What it's implying is that when we analyze a hockey game, we think, because of the scoring race system and our fantasy pools and so on, we tend to think that the way the game is played to maximize wins is for you to score at even strength and then add more goals on top through your power play. The actual analysis says the way you do it is you score at even strength and then protect those goals by stopping the other team from scoring and catching up. And that's why the penalty kill is more important than power play.
Terry, I've got a question, too, about a piece I'm reading on your website. Jordan Eberle, the next Theo Fleury.
That's right.
Now, when I look at this, having watched both players and Theo when he was in the Western Hockey League, I don't think you could pick two players who are more distinctly different than these two. I'm curious as to what led you to these comparisons. I'm seeing some of the things you talk about, a max rating with Eberle and how efficient he's been this year.
Right.
And then you further break it down. He's doing other things that go unnoticed but are essential aspects of winning play at the wing position. And one is you've got disciplined play. No insult intended to Theo. Disciplined play was never an aspect of his game.
That's right.
As a player. So I'm just a bit curious about the comparison.
Well, what we're talking about there is, first of all, I got to back up and tell you a little bit about the PowerScout system, because that's what it all stems from. When we look at how we build a team, because we're so familiar with the scoring race system and fantasy pools and so on, we tend to evaluate a goal and assist as being equal in terms of importance to winning. And it's a natural thing to have happen, because that's the way our scoring race is settled. But when you do the analysis and determine the actual value of goals and assists by position, what you find is that a goal and assist are not equal when it comes time to talk about winning. And if you stop and think about that, you'll realize that that's really, in fact, the case. And I'll give you an example. Suppose there's two players that are tied for the scoring race and they've each got 100 points, but they've got diametrically opposite kinds of individual statistics. One has got 100 goals and no assists, and the other's got no goals and 100 assists. They both play the same position, so it's not position-related. You would have to say that the player that's got 100 goals and no assists is much more valuable, because nobody in the league has ever got 100 goals. I mean, Gretzky's 92 is the most. Whereas there's a multitude of players that have gotten 100 assists. That's number one. Number two, you cannot get assists without a goal. So a goal is always preeminent to an assist. So when we did the analysis, what we found is that because there's this different weighting between goals and assists, the positions are different in terms of their contribution to winning. And so when you look at a team, you can't just say, using the scoring race system, that a winger is equivalent to a center, because a winger is off to the side and not in the same kind of position on average that a center is. And so as a result, it's much more difficult to score and contribute to team winning from that position. Now, with respect to Eberle and Theo Fleury, you're quite right. They're quite different in terms of their, we'll call it, chippiness that they played. But the similarity is was in size more than anything. The statistics and the contribution that Jordan Eberle is making to the Oilers is equivalent to what Theo Fleury did in 1991. And what we were suggesting there is that because they're the same size, play the same position, and excepting for this discipline, which is really a proxy for penalty minutes, what we're saying is that Jordan Eberle is on the same kind of career path that Theo Fleury was on. And so that's why we're saying that there's a comparison there.
Interesting stuff, you know, when you break down players. And it's obviously hard, because now when you mentioned Theo Fleury's numbers from 1991, Terry, do you take into the fact that scoring overall is down? So do you prorate it from...
Yes, I do. We normalize the statistics based on how difficult it is to score. And certainly it's harder now than it was, say, when Wayne Gretzky was playing. Although this year's scoring is up on average compared to last year and the year before. So that's made the adjustment less than it has been in the past. But, yeah, we normalize them for difficulty of season.
Now, when you look at a player, and you talked about goals being more important than assists, which is funny because we're always taught as players, the coach, you know, an assist is just as good as a goal, and I understand that from the young age, as it should be, but in the outcome of the game, you mentioned centers to wingers and that the centers. Now, when they are in the offensive zone, though, if you're a playmaking center, you're not as often in the middle of the ice. You'd normally be playmaking from the corner boards looking for the guy in the slot. So doesn't that change that, you know, the winger to center analogy?
Well, it does. I mean, for that example. But the question is, how many examples are like that? I mean, most of the game, as I said, 54% of winning is even strength. And so an even strength, the center is not necessarily in the corner as often as he would be on the power play, for example. So in that sense, that example, when we talk about centers and wings and the strengths and weaknesses by position, we're talking about it in a general sense, not in a specific one play or one power play or one game kind of time frame. So it's a general look at the position relative to the other positions, also looked at in a general sense.
Okay, one other thing interesting when it comes to the penalty kill and the power play, because I'm sure a lot of our audience is like, whoa, how can the penalty kill be three times more? And if you look at statistics of some teams that don't have a good power, that don't have a good penalty kill, yet they're very, you know, the Toronto Maple Leafs, for instance, right now this year, their penalty kill is atrocious, yet they've got a pretty good record. Now, and that, though, I'm guessing that can be attributed to, you can have five games where maybe you go and allow three power play goals and five chances, right? So your overall number is brutal, but from a game-to-game basis, it can change. When you're studying that, do you do it encompassing for an entire game, or, I mean, entire season, or is it on a game-to-game basis?
When we determined the actual weighting, we did it on a whole season and across a number of seasons. So it's a general look across all the teams, for and we do it actually on a season-by-season basis, and then roll it up across a number of seasons. If, you know what? It's so simple to do this. You don't need our analysis either. If you just look at the position of the teams and the standings, net of loser points, I might add, and look at the relationship between penalty killing percent and the position in the standings, and do the same with power plays, you'll find a much, much tighter fit with the data with penalty killing than you will with power play.
Okay, so the Edmonton Oilers, you know, their penalty kill is ninth in the league, yet they're 27th. How come?
Right.
And their power play, by the way, is fourth.
Look at your even strength situation, though.
Well, they're only minus nine, right, in goals for and against?
Well,
on even strength, right? There's 70, because I did the number. There's 75 goals against and 66 goals for, right? Okay. And they're fourth in the league in power play. They're ninth in the league in penalty kill. Now, I broke it down a little bit more. The difference is they're losing a lot of one-goal games.
Yeah, that's right. And in a situation, one-goal games can make a difference. It's a little different losing 7-1 twice and losing 4-1 seven times kind of thing. So it does make a difference on how badly you're getting beat. The Oilers, I guess the main problem for the Oilers is that they would be doing even better, and so would Toronto for that matter. To call you in your example, they're doing okay with their penalty with the weak penalty killing they have, but they would be doing even better if they were to improve it and just get to league average. In fact, as I was pointing out in an interview yesterday, if the Leafs, for example, were to improve their penalty killing from the 73.5% it is now up to 82%, which is league average, the team would actually gain the same amount of goals as they would as if they had 30 fights. So it's a situation where the number of fighting going down is a reflection of the fact that other aspects of the game are more important. And I think you were touching on with Keith earlier about some of the reasons for that.
Terry, one thing I wanted to ask you, it involves another Oiler, not Eberle, but this max rating where you do mention Eberle. You also mention Tyler Seguin of the Bruins. Now, obviously, there's some interest in him here because he was second to Taylor Hall in the draft year, and there was great debate among people about who they should take. Where is Seguin ranking right now for his position with your max rating compared to Hall for his position?
Seguin is on the wingers, he's in the top, I would say, five. He's Kessel is the first is the best winger in the league right now on the basis of that, and Seguin and Marchand are unless they've changed in the last game or two are in the top five.
And Taylor
Hall? Hall is down a little lower. He hasn't partly because he hasn't got the same kind of team to work with. Let's be fair to Taylor Hall, but also because it's at this stage his development is not at the same level as Seguin. I think in the longer term, Seguin is going to present a little better opportunity because he has the ability to play center. And center in the PowerScout system is way more important position than wing. So when the Boston Bruins right now, as I see them, are set for the next 10 years, the way they're building, because they've minimized the difficulty that Sagan has, in the sense that he's inexperienced, and inexperience is a real negative at center and on defense. So Hopkins, for example, just to move to center for a bit,
mm-hmm.
Hopkins' major problem is that he's inexperienced, and the only way you get experience is you got to play, and when you play, you make mistakes, and so you got to live with all the mistakes that these kids make when they come up. The easy way to minimize the mistakes at center is to move that player to the wing where the boards can help him play defense. And you let him stay there until he gets enough experience that you can move him to center. So in the case of Boston, they've got Tyler Seguin over there, who's playing wing, who's actually playing out of position, let's say, because he's a center. But they've got him off to the side where his speed works well because he's fast, and also because he's got inexperience, they've minimized that liability. So he's able to contribute a lot to Boston because they've minimized the things that he would do to hurt the team, and they've optimized all the things that are good. And Taylor Hall, I'll be honest with you, I think Taylor Hall should be considered at center for the Oilers because he has the attributes of a center. He's aggressive. He likes to shoot. He's a good scorer. He's big. He's fast. Everything you want in a center. But when you have him off on the wing, what you have is you have him at a position where the position itself makes it very difficult for him to contribute to the same amount as the same kind of contribution would be if he was at center.
It's great stuff. We'll keep reading it, Terry. We'll have you back on the show soon. I appreciate your time.
Okay, thanks a lot for having me.
Terry Appleby from PowerScoutHockey.com. I'm sure a lot of Oilers fans would agree with that. There's been a lot of conversation about having guys in the middle, a player like Taylor Hall with his size and speed. If you had Nugent Hopkins and Hall in the middle, some would suggest that that might be better long term. We'll take a quick break, come back, get some of your thoughts via email, Gregor at theteam1260.com and our SLA.